Hey, it's Tim, Pickup Truck Plus SUV Talk, and today I'm in our long-term review vehicle, the 2023 Chevy Silverado 1500 Duramax Diesel. I bought this for the channel for the year, and it just occurred to me I've eclipsed the six-month mark. So it's about that time. I update you guys. Would I buy it again? Would I sell it? Would I never buy it? I name myself tomorrow. You know, all the kind of stuff, questions in the comments. Do I love it? Do I hate it? Lots of details. So in this video, let's go ahead and talk about the first 6 months of this truck. Let's talk about whether I like it, hate it, my list I made to keep myself on track today about things on the truck, and just overall, we'll talk about oil usage, talk about def, we'll talk about all these different things about ownership of this truck. As you know, if you watch the channel, you'll see myself, Tim Esterdahl. If you're ever curious how to pronounce that, I would go with Tim, it's a little bit faster for me. My managing editor, Justin Middle, aka not my wife, her and I both review trucks and SUVs throughout the year. We also go to events where we take a first look at a vehicle. We take a first drive of a vehicle if we can, if it's able to be driven, because first looks, you don't can't drive under static displays. We also, like I said, do a 7-day week loan with a vehicle and do a review on that. And if you're lucky like me and you have a big enough audience, and thank you guys for watching, I'm able to actually afford to buy a truck, which I really love doing, because when I buy a truck, I get the whole ownership experience like you guys get. Press loans always come to me. They're always polished. They're always everything set up for me. I love the fact I have to input my radio presets. I have to do my driver information. I can sign in these accounts. I can set up my phone with the app. I mean, all the things you guys get in ownership experience that I don't experience when I do a press loan. Plus, I can have warranty work done. I can take it in a dealership for oil changes, get oil analysis, lots of good stuff. And I'm getting close to doing that, by the way. So let's talk about the key things I like about this truck and the key things I think you guys need to consider with this truck if you're shopping for one. First of all, the like list, number one, absolutely, hands down number one, mile per gallon. Holy cow. I have done 100-mile drives of this. I've drove across Colorado back to Nebraska. I got 30 miles per gallon. I have done towing tests, 21 towing a car. I think I got like 12 towing a camper. I've done some tests with this stuff that this truck just dominates in mile per gallon. I cannot get the same results out of a naturally aspirated small displacement engine. V8s even, I can't get the same performance out of this inline six turbo diesel. This thing is fantastic. So if you're looking for mile per gallon and that's the top of your list for trucks, and this is not number one, I don't know what you're thinking, because this thing is fantastic. Now, there is cost per mile, which is a different metric where you calculate how much it costs you to drive per mile. And, you know, diesel fuel is more expensive, you have def. Oil changes aren't that much different than gas if you do them yourself at a dealership, about 50 bucks more. If you take those into consideration, you have a lot different math equations and spreadsheets and such. I just know for myself, when I hop in this truck every day, if I drive every day, some days I don't. Some days I drive the other press vehicles. But every time I hop in this truck and I click the turbo odometer and it says I get 24 miles per gallon as soon as I hop in. And then if I reset that and actually go for a real drive, I easily get 28, 29. I mean, that's awesome. That's just flat out awesome. I've had the hybrid F50. I've had the Toyota Tundra last year. It never would show me above 20. When I first got into it. So, you know, every day I hop in and it's above 20, it's fantastic. It's just great. To me, it's like peace of mind. Like, we're gonna go to Missouri in a couple days. I can take this. I have no qualms about driving Missouri and back. 1,000, 2,000 miles, who cares? Because the range on this is excellent. I know it's got a 24-gallon tank. People get concerned about that, but I've always had about 500 miles of range. And I don't know about you, but 500 miles divided by 60 miles per hour, what is that, 60? Three, no, it's, why'd I do math on this channel? You know I hate math. 8 hours? I mean, that's 8 hours of driving. When I drove across Colorado, I stopped to check the tires a few times, if you know what I mean, and that was it. I never stopped for fuel. So, I mean, 8 hours, that's great. I don't need to go 14, 16 hours without filling up, and I can go weeks at a time without filling this thing up. So no problems there. Number two is smooth. I mean, this is such a smooth riding truck. Again, it's big enough for the family. All of us fit in here because a crew cab. It's smooth. It's highway. I would take this in a road trip. It's like, I'm going to take it on a road trip. I have no qualms taking this on a road trip, because road trips are awesome in this truck. Quiet. Yeah. You don't get that big diesel sound, the blah, 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 diesel sound. No, it's really quiet. You don't have any of those concerns as far as sound in the cabin. It's very quiet riding truck. Quiet. When I'm driving, it's really quiet. Really have no problems there at all. A couple of things I'll show you in a minute, but I want to get to a couple of dislikes before I get outside and get my thing going, my camera going. Oil usage, right? So, I checked the oil a couple weeks ago before I went on these massive trips, these business trips I was taking to see the new Tacoma and see the new Overland Expo and see the new Ranger, all that kind of stuff. And I mentioned that video, I was down to 2 quarts. So, this comes from factory with 7 quarts. 8 quarts. It takes 7.5 quarts for oil changes. They overfill a little bit in the factory as things kind of, per factory, I'm guessing, before things seat in, before things get worked on the engine, they add a little more oil to it. I'm down 2 quarts. I'm still dry dipstick, and I have still 5 quarts in the engine. That's a good thing. However, I mean, I have a new oil pan I need to add, which I just haven't got done yet. But my point of view on oil is this: does the oil usage bug me? Yeah, to a degree. So as you know, the other video I did, there's actually a technical service bulletin that tells customers that you could have an accepted rate of oil usage. What's interesting about that statement is I've had arguments in the comments, I've had arguments from engineers, arguments from mechanics about whether or not engines use oil. I'm not gonna get an argument. I just know this one does, and that's a concern of mine as owner. Now I'm thinking about this, so like I have to go to Missouri tomorrow. I have to go buy oil to put in this, I wanna make sure I have 7 quarts. I don't wanna have any problems on the road. I wanna grenade my engine, obviously. And my biggest bitch about the whole deal is that I can't find the oil. I've been to Walmart, I've been to O'Reilly, I've been to Napa, I've been online. I'm gonna have to drive to the dealership today and get a couple quarts of oil from them because it's OW20 Dexus D oil. Now that's not a GM thing as far as can't find the oil, that's a marketing thing with the retailers. Retailers aren't carrying it. And we know it's a lighter weight oil these days because it makes sense. The engine tolerances in these engines are so tight, you don't need the bigger oil. You can run it thinner oil, it's more efficient, it just makes overall for the engine wear and tear, it's a more efficient oil usage. And I've talked to different oil companies, talked to engineers, that's what they kind of tell me these days. OW20, it's thinner, but it actually is a better quality oil for the newer age engines. So my biggest bitch is it's not about using it. I have to put DEF in this anyways. I have to put the windshield wiper fluid in. I check the oil, just one more thing. And it's really, from the standpoint of it, is that we should all be checking our oil more often. And so this is kind of a good thing to make sure, remember to check the oil. My bitch is I can't find the damn oil. So it's just frustrating there. And it's frustrating also to have to think about it. Like, I'm gonna go on a road trip, I gotta make sure I have oil. Like, that's my 1962. This is 2023. All right, hold on, let me interrupt you for a minute. Just stop at dealer to get some more of this Dexus D AC Delco light duty and diesel motor oil that you have to have for this truck. And here it is, the mysterious oil you can't find anywhere. I couldn't find it anywhere around town. There's no substitutes. In the diesel supplemental manual, it lists a bunch of substitutes. I typed all those in on the internet and typed in Napa and O'Reilly, and they were like, what are you talking about? That's kind of a bitch. The other bitch is this stuff's $9 a quart. Yeah, that's pretty expensive oil. And oh yeah, by the way, there was made an issue about top tier diesel, which is the owner's manual as well, that's a diesel fuel to recommend. Yeah, can't find that either. But this is my overall kind of complaint. This is the issue, one issue I have is I'm going on a road trip, and so I'm getting my stuff out. I'm getting my more DEF fluid out, getting my open motor oil out. I need to add more to this truck because I can tell I'm gonna need more on the road trip, going 1,000 miles. So it's something I should do anyways, but it's kind of it's kind of a bitch. I just can't get in this thing and drive like I normally would other trucks because I have to think about oil. I think about DEF. I don't love that it uses oil. I don't mind it so much, but it just had my mind of always thinking about I have to add oil, maintain my oil, check my oil. Yeah, not fun with that. So hopefully it gets better. And speaking of getting better, I have some plans over here and more videos coming because, yeah. It's about to get crazy! The other things that I was thinking about with DEF, so let's talk about DEF because that's always going to be a topic on these videos. I don't think it's a big issue. It's not really a dislike. I just put it down as disgust because it's not really that big of an issue. People want to make this DEF is this huge thing, delete your truck, all this kind of stuff. Well, A, I'm not deleting the truck because that'd be stupid, right? I'm on camera. I'm on YouTube. If I delete my truck and show you how to do it, don't you think I'm going to get the EPA police after me? Hello? Yeah. Secondly, I don't want to void the warranty. I don't take stuff off of it. And third, I get 30 miles per gallon, have great power output and smooth ride. So what am I going to get from deleting it? I just have to put in DEF in? Well, I'm sorry, but you can go to Walmart and get DEF for $10 a jug or $20 a jug. I happened to buy the Platinum the other day. I got $20 a jug for this. It's 2.5 gallons. And people are like, well, that's just a waste of money. I'm like, I just spent $67,000 on this truck. I can afford $10 more for death at Walmart. It's not that big of a deal. So, yeah, I think I put in two containers of death in the last 5,000 miles. I've done some towing. I've done normal driving. I don't know. I mean, I've had owners tell me that they use less DEF the more the engine gets broken in. So maybe there's that too. But to me, I just go buy it and put it in the garage. When it says it's low, I go get more DEF. I don't know. It's just, I know people are going to get mad at me in the comments, going to tear me apart, but the truck needs it. It's like buying gas. I get it. Now, my only bitch about it is that this DEF tank, I think it's 4 gallons, and you buy 2.5 gallons in the DEF containers. So unless you go to the dealership, or not dealership, but unless you go to a fuel pump that has DEF and diesel in the same pump, you can't really fill this up with DEF. You get close. Like, I'm a little less than half because I have these little lines. I'm going to put my 2.5 gallons in and try to get all the way in. I want it to be full. So it's kind of a little pain in the butt. So you constantly are managing different, you're never really 100% because unless you find that gas pump that's got both DEF and diesel built into it. And so there's that. So let me flip the camera on because I have a bunch more to tell you about on this truck. Okay, the things I like, well, that includes the outside. I just like the way this truck looks. This is the dark ash metallic in the high country trim. I know people don't like chrome these days, I get it, but I just think this is a sharp looking truck. It doesn't have that much chrome to me. It's got kind of the right amount. The grill is not overly chrome. I don't know. This is a good looking truck to me. And like I said, a dark ash material. Here's that Duramax. Kind of hear probably better over here. Yeah, I mean, I call that pretty quiet. I can go through drive-through in order to drive through with this Duramax diesel. If you remember 1990s and 2000s, that was not a choice. And we have it on the back with the Silverado, and I have the step-in. You know, kind of my complaints about it is I wish I had parts availability was better. I'd like to have the multi-flex tailgate back there. I wish I had heads-up display inside the cabin. I wish I had a sunroof. But those were all parts of the limit, so I couldn't get those. Looking at the inside. So these are the Proven Ground floor liners. I put a video up on that, or story up on that as well. I have a bunch more mods coming, but this is the storage. This is kind of a little bitch to me. It doesn't really have a whole lot of storage options. I have a flat flowing floor. I don't really have much more beyond this. I can fit my overly large snow brush in there, but that's about it. So, I mean, if you're looking for more storage, you just can't find it. And my kids the other day actually finally discovered this secret storage spot, which I really don't know what you put in there. Beer, whiskey, drugs, who knows? All right, there's that. And then, oh, the outboard seats are heated as well. I just let a note there, USBs. So the kids really fit well back there like that. Okay, inside the cabin. I will tell you, these seats, if you know this channel, you know GM seats have always been kind of a bane of my existence. These seats are better. The Silverado High Country seats are better. The LT, LTZ, I don't know, those seats are questionable to me. But these seats, for whatever reason, just feel better to me. Go by. My theory, and talking to different engineers about this, especially like heated steering wheel as well, is I theorize it's the leather. I think this leather is more comfortable for the higher trim level. I think the lower trim level has more cloth, or they have a cheaper leather, and it doesn't feel like it holds up as well. That'd be kind of my 2 cents on that. But this is the way the interior looks. This is after 5,000 miles of wear and tear. People talk a lot about this gloss black, and yeah, it does get dirty. It gets dirty really fast, and if you're OCD, you're gonna have a problem. Fortunately for me, I'm not that OCD. one of the things I do like is a shifter. So I know there's lots of conversation online. You want it here, you gotta have a shifter here, that's a real truck. And I get that. My brother actually got a Sierra Denali, he was driving around, and had the same problem. He was so used to going here for a shifter, he wasn't used to going here. But I will tell you, the benefit to going here is I have all the storage space around it. So once you get used to it, it's great because it doesn't interrupt your storage space. It's nice and concise. It's not the stupid dial that Ram's got. It's not a big clunky thing that blocks air vents like this. And it just fits well. Now I know in heavy duties, we do have the column shifter. And that's really better for towing. Towing and plowing. If you're plowing a lot, you're back in reverse and drive a lot. But in a half ton, I'm not plowing snow. So this seems like it just works well. And I could put a bunch of stuff around here, cups and everything, and don't have to worry about the shifter. It seems like that is a win for me because it's not so obtrusive. Rest of my list.
Yeah, so we talked about that. Yeah, so the other thing is the infotainment system. So this is kind of an interesting system. I've gotten used to it. I'd like it. I really like the clock over here. Big fan. And I'm a big fan of they left this on at dealership, and I'm hoping I'm going to go get another one, maybe matted. I've saw some people that sell these as matted, because fingerprints get all this stuff all the time. The other trucks get fingerprints. But with this case, because I have this cover on there, you don't get fingerprints like you would a cell phone. What I will tell you is I've never had any issues with the infotainment system except for my phone. Okay, so every once in a grand while, the phone won't connect right, the CarPlay and CarePlay won't connect right to the phone, and I have some weirdness going on. And I will tell you, talking to different engineers about this, it's not about their infotainment system. It's about Google makes an update, or Apple makes an update, and they're trying to chase those updates down. And what I've heard from different manufacturers is Apple is not so easy to play with. They don't love sharing their stuff. And so when they do an update, it takes them a little while to figure out what's going on and make sure the system works. So it's not really a GM thing. It's more of an Apple thing with the infotainment system. Overall, I love it. It's great. It's quick. It's fast. Everything loads pretty well. So no big deal there. And yeah, big fan of it overall. But there are some weirdness that happens. There's a guy online, he emailed me. Sometimes his system doesn't play any sound at all. And I asked him about his phone, and he said his phone's always with him. So I think the phone is the issue, not system at all. And there's just some weirdness going on. Just be aware of that. The other thing, I didn't like the multi-flex tailgate. They got all the options because it was parts delayed. They just couldn't build the trucks with those parts. And I wish I would have had the wireless charger. So this is a fantastic spot. It's built in. Your phone goes right in. It's awesome. But parts delays, parts shortages, I couldn't get the wireless charger. I could if I waited like 4 or 5 months to get my truck, right? Because it sits in dealership lot, or it's just in lots of some manufacturers. It's got that quality hold situation going on. But I wanted a truck. I had to have it by year end. So I wish I would have got that. That's kind of my only complaint is I plug in here, or I can plug it in the center console. But my goodness, this thing is just perfect. That storage space is just awesome. I just wish it would wireless charge. And I wish I had the digital camera mirror. That was also parts shortages. This is okay. This is what we're used to. I get it. But I like that digital camera mirror for at night. At night, it's got a video display, and that video display cuts down the amount of glare coming into the cabin. So that's one thing I do wish I would have had with that. I don't even have a... This is auto dimming, so I don't have any sort of thing to flip. So yeah, interesting there. Last thing I want to talk about is kind of a small issue, but the auto headlights, they could be a little bit better. I have a lot of times when I have auto headlights on where it's the auto high beams. Let me be more clear. Auto high beams picks up street signs and such. In the country, it's pretty good. When I'm driving anywhere into town or through town, like I drove home that night about 11 o'clock at night from the airport, and it was just going nuts, and it just drove me up a wall, so I stopped doing that. So auto headlights could be a little bit better, but that's auto high beams could be a little better, be more accurate. But that's something industry-wide they're getting better at, as far as the truck will turn on the headlights, turn off the headlights, as far as the high beams, when it sees traffic coming at it. So it's an automatic system. So auto high beams is a great feature, like I said, for getting out in the countryside. But around town, when I'm driving through town, it's just too much going on. The system can't read it. That'd be my only issue with that would be there. So let's go for a drive and wrap this up. Okay. Let's go ahead and get on it. I mean, it's a lot of fun. It's pretty quick for a diesel half ton, I will say. It's not sports car quick, but plenty of power, smooth, quiet, powerful. I don't know what else I can say on that. I go through dirt roads, I go across road tracks, and this does not leave my back in pain. That's the best way I can say that. So let's go ahead and talk about, would I buy it again? Should I buy it again? Whatever, all the kind of stuff that happens in these videos. So it's at 6 months, I really still love everything about the truck. I really haven't found anything besides my dislikes. Like I said, the oil, infotainment at times, the wireless charger, the auto headlights, and the seats. I really haven't had any, as far as big issues with that. I do have a weird trailer light issue on the back. Doesn't always illuminate the trailer lights. And I swear, the front right parking sensor once in a while goes batshit crazy. I don't know why, but it does. It's little small details in the first 6 months that I did not. It's just what sometimes happens in new trucks. They always come off the assembly line. They build them as best they can, make sure it's perfect as they can. But things happen.
things. I'm not too worried about it. I spent $66,050 somewhere in that range. I came back here, had to put about $1,500 in for registration fees, I believe. So, I mean, out the door, my new outdoor price was like $68,500 somewhere in that range, which frankly, I think is a pretty darn good price for a full-size truck in the luxury trim of the high country. I know I'm a bit torn apart in the comments on this, but if you look at the overall marketplace, what average transaction price of trucks are and where you're at, I mean, 60, 68 out the door, whatever, and the Tundra I bought last year, which was one trim up from the SR5, which is basically their beginning trim, it was limited, was 62. So for $5,000 more, I got, to me, a nicer, more premium interior, better materials, and I also got the Duramax diesel engine. So yeah, I think it's worth it for that $5,000 more, personally. But I know truck pricing is a sore spot for a lot of people in the right. I mean, trucks have gotten really expensive. There's no doubt about that. So would I buy it again? Oh yeah, buy it again all day long. This has been one of my favorite half-ton powertrains I have ever been in. Would I buy this or a GMC? I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of decisions to be made there as far as what you want. And here, I'm gonna hit these pretty hard. That's a railroad crossing. I mean, that's not bad at all. And I probably would have done better if I was driving faster. So, again, comfortable. So would I buy it again? Yeah, I'd buy it again. Favorite half-ton powertrain on the marketplace is this one right here. I know people talk about it. It doesn't tow a lot. It tows like 13,000 pounds as far as it's not a heavy-duty engine. 13,000 pounds. I have 1,600 pounds of payload. But this is really more of a family, long-distance driving, occasional tower vehicle to me, and that fits my needs perfectly. I think for the price, it's a great price. I've had, like I said, when I talked about the pricing being the average in the market, I think that's pretty decent too. I'd be sad when I sell this. As you know, I gotta buy a new truck every year, and when I buy a new truck, the old truck goes away. And in this case, I'll be sad when I sell this because I have really thoroughly enjoyed this truck. And I'd love to do more long-term testing, but the reality is I just don't drive it after the first year because I'm driving a new truck and I'm driving a new Prestone and stuff like that, so it just doesn't work out. I think I'm done rambling. I think I rambled way too much this video. All right, so for more, check out videos over here, website down below. As always, thanks for watching. I will see you down the road.